So I want to get started with my presentation here. Have you ever thought about what elements of video games have you used outside of playing video games? Can somebody give me an example? Any examples? Anybody use Facebook? LinkedIn? Percentage profile completed? Seen that in LinkedIn? Okay, likes in LinkedIn? Anybody use Yammer for your office networking purposes? Not really. Oh, you use Yammer. What do you use it for? Wall and updates. Okay, cool. How do you like it?
It's great. It's sort of a duplicate model of Facebook for a smaller group.
Yep.
So a lot of collaboration through it, polls and other things that you can keep updated about if you have a really large company. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty cool.
Cool. Isn't it awesome, right? What you saw here was actually Bottle Bank, and they gamified the system, and it's done by a company called the Fun Theory. You might have seen the piano staircase in YouTube video. Anybody seen that? Right? It's the same company, basically, right? So we're really looking about what gamification is, right? This is me. You can tweet about this session at AI2013-gamify. It's going to be fun. And this is about me. I work in big and small companies. I do a lot of consulting work. I'm based out of New Jersey, visiting here for this conference, right? Have a couple of certifications, but I don't really find value in that. I want my money back, except for maybe the ARSC and maybe Innovation Games Qualified Instructor, right? There are a couple of disclaimers. One, I was trained as an engineer. I'm going to be talking about psychology, cognitive sciences, biochemistry, and other stuff which I have no expertise in. We have experts in the room, Linda, Rebecca. I'm very honored to have them here. So I might not have answers to all your questions. Okay. Second thing is, I'm going to be talking about gamification, but I'm not a gamer myself. Whatever I learned was through my experience, observation, reading, and through interacting with people. So, what is a game? Have you ever thought about it? Anybody want to try to define what is common between cricket, chess, and Angry Birds?
There are people participating in the game.
Uh-huh.
And the objective is to win.
Uh-huh.
The objective is to win and
the objective is to win and have fun. Okay.
Common is hit something.
Sorry, hit something. How about chess?
Check.
Okay.
We do hit there.
How about Tetris?
Fill something.
Okay. Right. It's very different and it's very difficult. Looks like philosophers have tried to define this and they have different opinion about this, right? It actually comes from a guy named Bernard Smith, who's a philosopher. He says, like, gamification means you have a pre-lucidary goals, rules, feedback, and a lucidary attitude. Ludus is actually a Latin word for play. And play actually means something with expression. You know, art is a form of play. And game is also a form of play. And in this, you actually overcome voluntarily obstacles which are not really necessary. I mean, nobody really said, okay, you should hit the ball in cricket, else the world will just collapse and it's doomed. You are participating in it voluntarily. So that's called pre-lucidary goals. I mean, the win states, the lose states are actually defined before you start playing the game. We have set of rules, right? Cricket, you play it by certain rules. 20-20, you play it by certain rules. Tennis, there are some rules. And you have feedback. And this is quite important from the video game industry. We have a lot of feedback built in. And you have a lucidary attitude. And by this, I mean like the spirit of game. Have you ever heard of something called body line in cricket? Right? What does it mean, body line?
You bring the ball at the body rather than at the wicket.
Why is it wrong?
It's difficult to play. And it's not really the gentleman way of playing the game.
Yeah, you lose the spirit of the game when you start doing that, right? So you need to have a spirit of the game, plus it's voluntary participation. Nobody can really force you to play a game, And if they force you, you're probably going to fail, and you'll just play without enthusiasm, right? It's fun and engaging, right? And that's why kids like to play a game. We all like to play a game. And people started asking this question. What if our workplace was as engaging and as much fun as playing games, right? Gamification is not a word yet in dictionary. And about 2004, 2005, a couple of guys started a company named Dodgeball, and they gamified the system, and then they actually sent it to Google. I mean, they sold it to Google. But they didn't have a couple of key ingredients, and Google kind of shut down Dodgeball. Anybody heard of the Dodgeball? Right? Yeah, because Google shut it down. Right? They started a new company with their experience called Foursquare. Heard of Foursquare? Right? And they were very successful with that. Right? So gamification has kind of propagated from the gaming industry to other industries, including marketing, education, learning, simulation, and other stuff. Right? And people are really looking at how we can make our workplace more fun. Right? The reason is very simple. Employee engagement, I mean, there are a lot of statistics about employee engagement, and you can actually see that in a company, the highest percentage engaged fully is about 20% or 25%, right? And rest of them are like only partially engaged, right? Depending on the nature of the industry. You have a lot of attrition here in India? Yeah, double digit, right? What's happening there? They lose the enthusiasm. I mean, the first 6 months, they're happy. And after that, they lose the enthusiasm, right? And Lew Platt, who was the ex-CEO of HP, told us, like, if HP knew what HP knows, it'll actually be three times as profitable as it is today. HP is a flat organizational structure, and they actually have very, dynamic environment, and a lot of knowledge needs to be shared between different people. But since they are very flat, they don't have a hierarchy, they don't have a process, he calculated and he figured out that it might actually be much better if they collaborate. And if they could collaborate on that knowledge sharing, HP would be three times more profitable, right? Now, I know a lot of people here are not gamers, right? We have Linda here. You don't game, Linda, right? But why should I care about it? I'm not a gamer either. In fact, I didn't care about games for quite some time until it struck me that I need to focus on this, right? Why should I care about gaming? Number one, it's the workforce which is coming in. Anybody heard of the term baby boomers? Right? After the Second World War, the soldiers returned back to the United States. The first thing they did was make love to their wives. The second thing they did was get their duffel bag off their shoulders. Right? And that generation is called baby boomers, and they were driving the economy. Guess what? Today, in another 5 years, the baby boomer workforce will be less than 2% or 5%. Right? Today, Generation X, Generation Y, and Gen Z are picking up, the millennial generations. And you'd be surprised that a three-year-old kid would know how to play a video game, but wouldn't know how to tie his shoe. So the question is, this generation is brought up playing games. How are you going to keep them engaged? Previously, our parents used to work for a company for 30, 40, 50 years. Now, switching company in 3, 4, 5 years is common. Why? Because you're not really engaged. Part of the problem. Right? The second thing is organizational health. I know Mary talked about, anybody here was there for Mary's keynote speech, where she talked about Southwest and Zappos, right? They are actually organizations built on very healthy culture. In fact, Zappos started off, they were very particular about their culture, and they even offered $5,000 to employees who wouldn't fit their culture so that they could just move out. Right? Initially it was $3,000. They increased it to 5,000. I have a great friend of mine, James Key Lim. He was number 4 or number 5 when Zappos was really growing. And now Tony Hsieh saw this and started another company called Delivering Happiness and Delivering Happiness at Work. And James Key Lim is a good friend of mine. He's actually heading this company. And he's actually seeing a lot of requests from companies looking for how can we be more productive? How can we have our employees more happy? Right? And part of the solution lies in how you are going to be keeping them engaged. Right? So the way we define gamification, I just took this off from Wikipedia, is use of game elements and game design techniques in a non-game context. Right? A lot of people are familiar with points, badges, leaderboards here. Right? Those are part of game elements, but they don't just complete. I mean, you build a website, you slap in points, badges, and labels. I mean, leaderboards, nobody's going to visit you, and your sales not going to skyrocket. Right? We'll talk about it in a little bit later. Right? And game design techniques is something which is borrowed from behavioral economics, psychology, as well as technology. We'll talk about it in some time. And non-game context is anything from business, non-profit, community website. A good example is Stack Overflow. Anybody remember a website named Expert Exchange? Right? What happened to Expert Exchange? I don't know. Are they still there? Yeah. Right? The guys who built Stack Overflow, anybody here in Stack Overflow? Right? What do you like about Stack Overflow?
We can ask the questions whenever we want. We need not to even pay for that, and we get badges and scores and all those stuff. So it's funny to you can ask your question as well as you can answer to others' question.
Yeah, Stack Overflow is a site which was built to take over Expert Exchange, and they successfully did it. The first guy you see there is John Skeet, and he works for Google, and he's a .NET guru. And he's still there with Google, and he wanted to give away his MVP, but there was a huge community uprising, and Google still let him have his MVP, Microsoft MVP. But there are other sites too, right? This is actually called the World Peace Game, where you teach world peace for 6 and 7 year olds with games. Have you ever thought about teaching world peace to kids with these games? You know, people fight for oil, people fight for a lot of reasons. But if you can really help them see the perspective of the other side, imagine what will happen, right? There are a couple of examples here. This is called Quest to Learn. There's a school in New York which is actually not teaching the regular syllabus. What they're doing is they're gamifying their entire system. And by that, students are becoming physicists and biologists and learning the stuff as though how a physicist would learn. Imagine learning about system thinking when you are in sixth grade, right? School is probably one of the most boring things for children, right? Anybody have kids who know that, right? Monday mornings, right? Imagine how excited would they be if it was more fun and more engaging. I'm going to skip this. Nike regained its brand name as a shoe when they actually put in Nike Plus, right? I'm going to skip over this example. But this is a little bit more relevant to our agile world. How many of you here have heard about innovation games? Okay, innovation games, a couple of hands, right? Luke Hofmann gamified the whole thing about how you interact with customers, gather requirements, and come up with an MVP, right? It's a great way to facilitate conversation between customers, business owners, product owners, product managers, developers, and the ultimate end users, right? He customized this version for the city of San Jose called Budget Games. You see politicians always fighting and just always playing the, oh, it's your fault, it's your fault, it's your fault game, and they always make decisions which is the safest bet for them. You know, they are not really willing to risk because they need to get elected the next time. He changed those games, customized it for them under the name of Budget Games, and this year as well as last year, the people of San Jose played games to actually do their budgets. Now, should we cut 100 policemen or should we clean up the park? There was an option which people made, and politicians were happy about it because they were not making the decisions. People were actually making the decisions. Right? We have Greenpeace, which is an international organization. James is from here. We will be doing some exercises in this session, and I have invited James for giving us some insight into what Greenpeace does and what is one of their challenges which they are facing. James, come on over. Thank you very much for coming in, James.
Okay, so I'm just going to do a very brief introduction of who Greenpeace are and what the real world issue is that we would like to think about how it can be solved in a game thinking way. First of all, I want to say thank you very much for inviting me along. It's a real privilege to be here. Then I'll get on with a very quick presentation. So Greenpeace is an environmental organization founded just over 40 years ago in North America. It works to try and bring about change by advocating at a policy level, generally with governments or large corporates, rather than taking on individual local battles. It tries to make change at a higher level so that then all those other battles can be won in one go once that legislation is put in place. So one of the issues that we're working on at the moment is the issue of climate change and the impact of using fossil fuels for energy. They don't just lead to climate change. They're polluting when they're burnt. Their extraction can be very damaging. The kind of mining industry, especially for coal, causes huge amounts of damage to the countryside and displaces lots of people, especially in India, where most of the coal reserves are actually under quite dense forest areas, which have large tribal community populations. And so we're looking at trying to encourage people to switch away from fossil fuels to renewable sources of energy, and in particular in India, to solar energy, because as I'm sure you're all aware, India is one of the countries in the world best placed to use, solar energy. So we need to educate people that it's a viable alternative, and it's becoming cheaper by the year to a point where it's close to reaching, at a small scale, reaching parity with fossil fuels. So we've been doing some work in Bihar already. So I don't know how much people know about the energy situation in Bihar, but it's an energy-starved state. The coal reserves in Bihar all went to Jharkhand when the state was divided. So there's a real need for extra energy there, especially to drive development in a state which is lagging behind the rest of the country in development at the moment. So with renewable energy at a small scale, there's no need to set up miles and miles of pylons and grid connections. Rural communities can then become self-sufficient in their own energy. And this model of DRE, or decentralized renewable energy, is becoming embraced by quite a lot of local politicians. We've got a good working relationship with Nitish Kumar, chief minister in Bihar, who's put manifesto pledges in about the amount of energy that will be delivered by renewables. And here you can see the picture demonstrating this solar panel is used to power irrigation for a village where we've set up a test case in Bihar. So the actual problem here that we're looking at is then how do you take this and make it work in an urban environment? So we're looking at Delhi, which is one of the states, well, union territories, with the lowest uptake of renewable energy, and yet has some of the richest and most affluent energy consumers in the country there. So how can we persuade people of the viability of solar power, perhaps on their rooftops or perhaps at a larger scale on government land, to help meet the energy shortfall that they have in Delhi? So back to Ram.
Thank you, James. We are looking at a challenge here, right? One is educating people about solar energy and then convincing them. And whoever was with Linda's keynote know that, and I was also in Linda's training, know that no amount of rational convincing would actually convince you, right? We are creatures based on emotions, and James can tell that it'll save you money, it's cheaper, it's alternative, but it's very hard for people to get convinced with rational arguments. How many of you know that? Right? We are going to be looking at challenge here, and what we're going to do is we're going to just play a small game to generate ideas so that we can help James with his challenge. I mean, that'll be part two, but this is actually generating ideas, and we'll really dissect our session. We play the game, and after that, we dissect our session about what principles of gamification we used, and then we'll see how it overlaps with Agile and Scrum and collaboration and what we have been talking about all 4 days. Sounds good? Right? The first thing is to know aspect of a challenge. The challenge he has is how do you educate and how do you help people adopt solar energy as their source of power in their homes, right? The aspect of the challenge really talks about motive. Why? Why would they want to do it, right? What prevents them from doing it, right? If you're actually sitting in the back, may I request you to come forward because we'll be working together in groups. groups of no more than 10. There's a reason for that. Groups of no more than 10. Come forward. Right? The aspect has a noun and a verb. Right? For example, right? Childhood obesity is a growing concern. It's a neutral statement. Right? The aspect of the challenge might actually be kids eat junk because it's easily available. That's one aspect of the challenge. Right? Another aspect is kids don't exercise because they play a lot more video games. Right? They're not physically exercising. Right? So we'll be looking at how we can generate different aspects of this problem. We'll evolve those ideas. We'll find out solutions. And we will dissect this session later. Shall we go forward? Whoever is going to be sitting in the back, they're probably going to be observers. We can fill in the tables. Tables probably no less than 7, no more than 10. If you're just 2 or 3, probably you can merge with other groups. No less than 7, no more than 10. And if you just want to just watch, I need a volunteer to maintain time. Anybody want to volunteer to maintain time? Any volunteers? You can? Thank you. You have a stopwatch? Okay. 3 minutes. No less than 6, no more than 10. So you can join. Maybe you can join them. And if you don't have a pair, just let me know. You can volunteer. Okay. So this is a challenge. Help people adopt solar energy. I'm going to be distributing index cards. Take some index cards. And you have constraints as well, like any game. Pass them all. Take 2 index cards per person. Take 2 index cards per person. Write down 2 aspects. Rebecca, 3 minutes for me. Write down 2 aspects of this particular challenge about helping people adopt solar energy for their homes. 3 minutes. Your constraints are, A, unset is your handwriting should be legible, so for other people to read it. 1 aspect per index card, less than 7 words, and 3 minutes. I have hints below. The motive, why? Look at the challenge and ask why would people want to do it or why would people not want to do it?
Can I split your team to other 4 teams? 1 for each team?
If I could do this from my computer, I would have run a stopwatch in the screen. But I'm just doing it from Rebecca's computer. Thank you, Rebecca. And I'm going to be telling you how much time you have. Have about 1 minute and 50 seconds. Move to the next step. Find a partner within your table. You're going to be pairing up with somebody. Exchange cards, Linda, 10 minutes. I mean, Rebecca, 10 minutes for me. Exchange your cards, brainstorm for possible solutions. Write down your solutions in the back of the card. 10 minutes. Find a partner within your table. If you don't have a partner, come to me. Stopwatch. So you know what to do now. I'll switch.
Silver bullet. Silver bullet.
I want to hear the silver bullet.
We will fire the bullet in classified
silver. So one person, I mean one pair has to own the problem and solution. Okay.
So, not widely used. So,
private grid. Second is lobby for subsidies. Lobby for subsidies.
Now we have visual feedback.
And then make it affordable for people. Make it affordable for people. Meter usage per house. Like how they have gas pipelines. If you could have hot water pipelines or electricity pipelines through the grid.
So you're saying you meter both the input and the output. So if a house is supplying to the grid, you meter that and you get credits for it.
Okay, let's start from here. Tell me your first solution.
I think the first solution.
First solution.
Yeah, we have ranked something called subsidizing the cost by having mass production, basically bringing down the cost by mass production or introducing subsidy.
Bringing down the cost by mass production or through subsidy.
Okay.
The
solutions.
Panels,
yeah, panels, solar panels. Okay. How about your first solution? What is your top solution?
They don't have to pay for it. If they don't like it after 3 months, it'll get ripped out, and the only requirement is they use it for 3 months, and they talk about being successful at having used it, so you have an existence proof.
10 words or less. 10 words or less. Okay. Okay, we need some reinforcement there. One house for 3 months. Okay, let's go and get the first solution from here. First, 10 words or less.
Subsidy, and then EMI. Give it on a monthly basis. And
One solution, 10 words or less. First solution.
Subsidy.
Subsidy.
Yeah.
Subsidize it.
Subsidize
it,
yeah.
Okay. Cool. Okay, let's go here. If it's repeated, probably we can just combine some of those ideas. If it's not a subsidy idea, pick up your second idea. If your first idea is subsidy, skip it, pick your second idea.
Okay, mandate this for all the new establishments or new homes that are getting built.
Mandate for new establishments and new homes. Okay. Cool. Pass your mic, this group. Anything which is not subsidy or mandate? Your second idea, which is not subsidy or mandate.
Creating awareness.
Creating more media. Awareness.
Yeah. Through
NGOs. Great. Hold on. Second idea.
A second of our idea, alternative currency representing carbon savings.
Alternative currency representing carbon savings. You know there are carbon credits, you know that, right? Yeah, so you can have that. Okay, if none of your ideas are actually here, probably you can talk it, else it's probably a repeat idea. You can skip it.
So this is on awareness and education.
Awareness and education.
Street place, school, putting in school curriculum.
Do we have awareness there already?
Okay.
Do we have education?
That was
there?
A problem.
What is the solution?
Well, street place and school, putting in school curriculum, educating through school curriculum.
Educating them in school curriculum. Okay. How many do we have, James? Educating them in school curriculum. Okay. Second solution, which is not there in the board, other than subsidy, education, awareness, carbon credits.
Availability of the maintenance and service centers.
Maintenance and service centers. Okay, maintenance, more maintenance and service centers. Right. We have about 8 ideas. Do you have any other idea which is so unique which needs to be here? You got one here? Okay, I'm going to pick only one team. What is your idea?
Freemium model.
So, as with any technology, we have problem with early adopters. You can give out freemium model, one bulb solar power if you want to purchase additional.
Okay, freemium model. Okay, anybody else? Okay, I'm going to stop here. Okay, freemium model. That's it. Okay, let's come on over. Now you're going to vote. When you're going to be voting, bring your index cards with it and give it to James. You got 3 votes. You can vote on any 3, but you cannot vote on the same item. So you have to distribute your votes amongst these 9 items. right? So you have 3 votes per person, right? So when you're coming in, bring your index cards and give it to James. Come on in. Start voting. Bring your index card and give it to James. And get the pen. And game design techniques in a non-gaming context. Is it a non-gaming context? Did we see about this? Is this a non-gaming context? Something which is of a social cause, right? We're going to be diving into the game design and game elements right now. If you're familiar with Microsoft, when they launched Windows 8, you probably didn't see the slides for this. Rick Ross was an engineer, a quality QA manager, and had this challenge. You know, Windows is kind of made in multiple languages, and he need to really make sure that the translations are right. And probably one thing which is worth noting is, like, he gamified that system, and people collaborated across nations to make sure that their nation is going to be winning. Japan won that particular contest, and it's a great, there are great literatures about it. You can probably Google it. I'll make these slides available, and we can talk about it later, right? Game elements. A lot of us know about points, badges, leaderboards. There are other game elements, including social graphs, avatars, quests, progression, and levels, right? A lot of us have played video games. The one thing with video games is they have a lot of game elements, and they give you a visual feedback all the time, right? But it's not just points, badges, or leaderboards, right? You need more than game elements to make the game a successful game or to make the gamified system a successful system. There needs to be some dynamics in the system. There needs to be some constraints, some mechanics, some components. I'm going to be giving out this. You can probably take one sheet, and it has all the details in it. And you can check out some of these elements which you are already familiar with. Now, probably if you have seen LinkedIn, you have seen some game elements. You have seen Facebook, you have seen some game elements, right? And it's not just about putting them together. It's about having these components which makes sense. It's actually a triangle there, what you see on the right. It's not showing up for whatever reason. So you probably will have a better one when we are giving the slides to Naresh, right? Let's debrief our game, right? Did we have a pre-lucidary goal? That is, did we have a goal before we got started? What was our goal? So come up with some solutions and ideas and possible ideas and solutions so that we can help James. Right? That was our goal before we got started. Did we have rules? Right? What rules did we have? Word limits, time limits, right? Those are constraints. Right? How about feedback? Did you have feedback? What feedback did you have? You had conversation. Yeah. You had voting. Some of the teams had voting. Right? Right? And then you voted here, right? How about a lucidary attitude? Was anybody forced here into this room, like, you have to attend Ram's gamification session, else you'll be fired, right? It was voluntary participation from everybody, right? How about the spirit of game? You are like casual, you are not fighting, quarreling, you are not making sure that your idea was winning. I gamed it a little bit, right? A pair generated the idea, but I gave you 3 votes. So even if you're really selfish, you voted for all your 2 ideas, you have 1 vote, which you would have to give it to somebody else. Right? I designed the system such a way that even though you're selfish, you cannot be more selfish than the system. Right? And what game elements did we use here, other than what we talked about? Read your flyer. What other game elements did we use? Collaboration, is it a game element? Yeah. What was the narrative? What was the narrative? Solar energy, right? We had a narrative, right? That's quite important. Did we have a progression? We had step 1, step 2, step 3, right? There are multiple elements which came together to make this thing work, right? Was there any surprise, chance, anything? Right? Not really, right? We'll make it happen. Who won? How many votes?
18.
19 is the highest? Mandates for new establishments. Whose idea is that? Stand up, please. Okay. Four people? Two. The idea has a pair. Idea was owned by a pair. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Right. Okay, now you have chance. Right? They won a prize. Right? Look at this. Look at Scrum. What game elements do you see? As a team, can you work together? We have about 3 minutes for this. As a team, can you work together? And let's see which team comes up with the maximum number of game elements. For example, if feedback is a game element, your burn down chart will count as one. Your sprint reviews will count as one. Your sprint retrospectives might count as one, just to give you an idea. 3 minutes to go. Are you still with your teams? Are you still with your team? 3 minutes. Yeah, I'm going to have the timer going. Are you still sticking with the old team?
Yeah.
You are? Okay. Okay. How many game elements can you identify? I'm conditioning you. Right? I gave you a prize. They came up with some numbers. Right? And I'm going to take my prize out and anyways, ask them to take it. I have some books. I'm conditioning them right now. Take four books, please. There's a reward mechanism going on here, right? Had I told you that come up with maximum number of elements and I'll give you a prize, you would have come up with 120, right? I didn't tell you that, but this is a surprise for you, right? When a surprise is happening, there's something going on in our brain. Dopamine gets released, right? And you actually are in a state of euphoria, right? And that's why material rewards give you some euphoria. We'll talk about dopamine and Maslow's pyramid in a little bit. But they weren't expecting or they weren't doing this for the reward. I gave them a reward. They're happy. How about you, Rebecca? Are you happy about this? You got this book? Are you happy that you got this book?
Yes, I am.
Oh, yeah, cool. We have four more. So I'll be using other game elements to give this away. So now you're more motivated to pay attention. Let's get started. Linda talked about this. Mary talked about this. Henrik yesterday talked about this. Change comes from within. How do you get a horse to drink water? Tell that water is good. Agile is a great thing to do. Everybody should be doing Agile. Or show pictures of Scrum and people going to CSM classes and all those kind of stuff. Entice them with money. Money is probably the most slippery thing. We'll talk about rewards in a little bit. You know, there's power, access, status, and money are physical rewards. And probably the most addicting is money or physical rewards, like the book I gave you. And you have to keep giving more. Now, the next time I ask you to work as a group, you know that I have something to give away. You're expecting me to give away something. Right, Linda? Yes? Oh, yeah. Cool. I'm conditioning you. Right? The best thing you can do to motivate somebody is find out the reason, the physical needs. You had a question. Yes. Yes. We need a mic. You have to make the comment without a mic. You have to be louder. Yes, exactly. I will talk about it. A lot of people say your carrot and sticks doesn't work, right? We all know that, but how do you really motivate somebody with intrinsic motivators, right? We did this. We actually looked at different aspects of the problem when we were actually looking at the power generation problem, solar power generation, right? We didn't really say, we didn't entice them with, oh, it's cheaper, oh, it is very economical for you. We looked at what is that benefit they might get, right? We looked at the aspect of the problem and a solution, right? We'll talk about intrinsic rewards a little bit, but you can game the system in a good way, okay? You're smart, you're gonna add some salt to oats to make the horse drink. I mean, a lot of people say, like, have you heard of the proverb, it's you can take the horse to the pond, but you cannot make it drink? Really, have you ever wondered why horse should drink water? Yeah, the challenge is, winters, horses don't drink water, right? And if they don't drink water, they can only survive for 5 days. But if they don't have food, they can survive for 25 days, right? They can go longer with water, but they don't drink water because they're not really working out in winter, so they're idle. And they actually get colonic infection and stuff like that, and they eventually die. And that's where the proverb came, like you can take the horse to the pond, but you cannot make him drink water, right? If you're smart, you add salt to the oats, and it'll drink water. Guess what they do when you go to a bar? You ask for appetizers, they add more salt to your appetizers so that you can drink more. The sale comes from drinking, not from the appetizers. Right? There's a small market. Anybody free here from marketing? I don't want to offend them, but you're an exception. I'm helping you. Okay? You have to know the reason behind why people behave the way they behave. Right? Game design is based out of a couple of concepts like behavioral economics. Anybody know what behavioral economics is? Right? People behave in predictable but irrational ways. Honey, there's a shoe sale going on. Oh, but honey, you already have 20 pairs of shoes. Oh no, it's just one pair, it's a sale going on. Go to the shoe store. How many pairs did you buy? 3. Buy one, get 2 free. Buy one, second one is 50% off, and the third one is 25% off. You didn't need 3 shoes, now you have 3 shoes, right? You go to a Subway store or any store, just one cookie won't kill you. You know you have diabetes, you're not supposed to eat cookie. You go there, you don't get one cookie, you get 2 cookies. Why? Because you are rationally convincing yourself that I will exercise tomorrow. People behave in predictable but irrational ways. Amazon.com, $25 free shipping. A lot of you know that, right? The second thing is human psychology, right? And understanding motivation and intrinsic rewards and Maslow's pyramid and stuff like that. And the third thing is technology, which is web, mobile, and social media and stuff like that. And the convergence of this particular 3 fields is what is actually kind of gaining traction. I mean, you didn't have gamification 20 years ago. Right? You have gamification now because the technology is enabling you to give feedback right away. Somebody is posting something in Facebook, your phone gets notified regardless of where you are. Right? People have social media teams. Dell has a social media disaster center, 24/7/365. Yeah, because somebody posts something in Twitter, guess what? They need to really moderate and contain the damage. Anybody know Tesla cars? Right? So New York Times did a drive from Washington, D.C. to Boston, and they really wrote a bad thing. And Tesla immediately wrote a blog saying they did the same ride, and they published the blogs and logs, and it went up in Reddit, which is a social media networking site, and that was a bad reputation for New York Times at that point in time. Right? Because each company now don't have to look up at media, they actually have their own media. They have evolved. And this is convergence of these 3 fields, which is actually helping a lot of things, right? And it's getting abused too. We'll talk about it later, right? Game designer looks at the aspect of the problem. What would motivate somebody to do something which they will not do on their own? How many minutes do we have? About 10 minutes. I'm going to rush through these slides, right? I'm going to skip this. What's the formula? I'm going to skip this. Okay, this is the formula. How do you really gamify something, right? We talked about, the title is actually collaboration through gamification, right? And if you really look at the aspects of collaboration, these are some of the aspects which I have come up with. One is, probably you know, asymptotic inequality is how they call it in anthropology. You know, if you play World of Warcraft, you have a priest who is actually not having very much power to attack, but he has the magic, right? So they together have to work as a team. Right? Everybody is equal, but everybody has different skills. We call it cross-functional development team in Scrum. Notice that, right? Positivity and likability is something which is important. This comes from, I forgot the name, this guy, John Gottman. John Gottman is a Seattle-based researcher. Anybody heard of the name John Gottman? His marital research. If you're in Microsoft, you're working in Microsoft, you actually get free consultations with him. And he identified the amount of positivity in a relationship, and he could, within 90 seconds, predict whether a marriage will survive beyond 4 years. 4 years is the period, the critical period where marriage really breaks down.
7 years. 7 years? 7 years.
Oh, okay. Right? And he could, within 90 seconds, could predict whether somebody would be living beyond 4 years or not. And he has some statistics. He says, like, the, it's not that a good marriage actually has no confrontations or conflicts. He says that the amount of conflict, the amount of positivity in a good relation is 5:1. And you can look at some of the researches which have been done for teams. Good teams have anywhere from 3:1 to 4:1. Very, very rare they have 5:1. Probably if it's a family-run business, probably they have, right? Tribalism is something which comes out of our sense for belongingness. Probably you saw a lot of people here in lunch hanging alone, and they were really looking. They were not eating, they were actually looking. Whom can I associate with, right? Humans have an innate tendency to be associated with somebody, right? And you can capture, these are some of the aspects for collaboration. I'm going to switch through these slides pretty fast. These are the different, how can you gamify a system now, right? These are the 6 steps which I'm probably going to be, you want to take note of this. This is something huge, right? This is called BJ Fogg's behavioral model. And he actually talked about how you can help people change behavior, right? This is crazy stuff, right? Describe your players. We know persona. We know device activity loops. I want to talk about this activity loops, right? Activity loop is something which keeps you engaging all along, right? My friend for 10 years was talking with him over the phone. Suddenly he says, he hangs up and says, dude, I got to go harvest my crops. I can't talk to you now. Dude, wait, you have a farm? No, I got to go to Farmville, harvest my crops. Dude, why don't you talk for 10 minutes and harvest the farm later? No, if I don't go now, I'll lose points, it'll dry up, there is nobody for me to harvest, I got to go now and harvest the crops. I got to go now, Farmville, game, meaningless, come on. You're talking with a friend for 10 years, you went to college with him, you studied with him, you stayed with him, and suddenly you're saying, like, you got to go to Farmville. Why? Because it's creating an engagement loop. Humans have a tendency to actually stick to what they have. They would work more harder to stick or retain what they have than to actually work harder to gain something new. So if there is a sense of loss aversion in humans, you can capitalize on that, right? Don't forget the fun, and there's something called flow. Flow is where you're operating at the edge of your skill, and video games are so good at designing this, getting you to the state of flow, right? They have levels, they have progressions. Ever felt that a video game is too difficult to play? A very good video game is too difficult to play? Never. Which one? Left 4 Dead. How many of you played Left 4 Dead? How many of you played Angry Birds? Okay, more hands than for Angry Birds than Left 4 Dead, because they have something called scaffolding, leveling, right? These are loops for you, I mean notes for you. You can probably talk about it later. This is again a triangle. It's not showing up here. The main thing is you got to look at how your dynamics work. Without dynamics, you don't have a gamification system. You just slap points, badges, and leaderboard. That system's going to fail. In fact, that's one of the reasons why gamification has attracted a lot of criticism from other industry, right? Why should I really care about gamification? You don't have to, but there are other people who do. Anything look familiar in this? I mean, think about a behavioral change, and you have LinkedIn, Facebook, Xbox, Kinect, Nike Plus. Right? They're talking about changing your behavior, right? And not only that, these behaviors over time become habits. It's surprising that in America, where people are focused on driving, I mean, teenage, what is the first thing you did, Linda, when you actually got your...
I got your license, as in when you got your teenage license?
What?
What is the first thing when you did, after you got your license, car driving license?
I don't know.
You love to drive?
Yes.
You drove a lot?
Yes.
There is a trend in America right now, right, where teenagers don't like to drive. You know what's happening? They cannot be in Facebook if they're driving. Okay. In fact, this is called second screen. Anybody watching TV, know that they're not just watching TV. TV conditioned us to actually have 20-minute attention span. This has conditioned us to have a 10-minute attention span, and TV channels are now going behind mobile networks and mobile application developers to develop apps so that you can be on a second screen when that screen's going on. Right, when a player is playing the favorite game there in cricket or football or basketball, something's happening here accordingly in your mobile, so you are now more engaged. Right? This is pretty dangerous stuff. You don't understand this, but people out there understand. Why? Because there's this chemical. Linda talked about influence. Mary talked about system one thinking and system two thinking. This is what's happening behind your brain. Anybody recognize what this chemical is? Dopamine. It's called dopamine. There's a reward system built in. Linda, you actually said dopamine. Okay, yeah. Unexpected reward for you. The reward system actually is a feedback system, right? You have a motivation, you take an action, and you get rewarded. You're more motivated to take that action again. You're learning that, right? You're forced to learn that. You can say, oh, I'm not like that, but you would be. You'd be conditioned to learn about that, right? This is important for you to understand that the reward system ties up with Maslow's hierarchy of needs with dopamine, right? Anything you do, food, sex, money, all trigger dopamine in different levels. Your physical rewards, pretty much, I mean, I wish I had this triangle. This is actually a triangle and this is an inverted triangle on the right. Whatever you see in the right, money, material rewards, they actually have low dopamine reception. So the first time you give them, the dopamine secretes an euphoria. And the next time, you have to give them more. Right? There's a way to come over this. Look at the things which are in higher things, right? Look at power, look at access, look at status, look at esteem. Not a lot of video games give you money to play. They say like, oh, they give you badges. Anybody, I mean, Stack Overflow, right? Why did you go there every day? Increased reputation. Means nothing in real world other than saying, oh, you know what? Somebody has approved my answers. I have a badge. I have so many points. I have a credibility. They didn't pay you to do that. Right? You go there every day. When you go there every day, guess what? You get a badge for 365 days. Your answers get upvoted. 20 upvotes, you get a silver badge or a bronze badge. You can show it off. It's status, access, approval. These are intrinsic rewards. Right? Now, if you understand this, we can pretty much start saying, Ram, I understand the mechanics behind this. I can start to gamify things. I can help my team improve productivity. I can create a set of conditions such that they are forced to collaborate, or I give them the environment to collaborate, right? I can give them the environment so that they can actually manage themselves without overseeing with some set of rules. Some of us call it self-governance, self-organized, right? We can get people to visit our website more often. Zynga does this. They give you small rewards. Beyond that, you're addicted to it. Now you got to pay to actually go beyond that certain daily cap, right? They make money off of it, right? Now, people start abusing this as well. Guess what? Gamification is not going to solve your problems. Maybe it might solve it for some time, but it might exaggerate it over time, right? You have a bad product, gamification is not going to make your bad product a great product. And taken to extremes, I think I have the fourth one missing there. If I can gamify stuff, that last one which actually says is like, I can make anybody do anything I want, which is a less of a remote possibility. But we are pretty much somewhere here at this point in time, which says that I can gamify stuff, right? And game industry has become very critical of this. And there's this guy named Ian Bogost who actually said, I hate people, gamification is bullshit. I believe the audio is not proper. So he's supposed to speak.
Welcome.
Let's see. Appropriate for the room is not appropriate for the speakers. You're not able to hear it, right? They're supposed to talk. Audio of this speaker is probably not very clear. Are you watching closely? Audio here. I'll probably stop it at this point in time. What's happening is this guy is going for a date, and he has this app built in, which actually helps him in his date. It's extreme gamification and imagination. But this possibly a possibility is probably these guys want to say. I don't know what they want to say. But it's very interesting on how we are being gamified in our society. Right? I had a quiz, but I'm probably going to skip it. These are my references. I want to thank these publishers for giving me these books for free. And the game continues. Thank you. Questions? Yes, sir.
Can I have one of the free books?
Okay, since you asked.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. And thank you, Rebecca.